Hello and welcome back. This is lecture 12A. This time around, we're going to be talking about type. This may sound a little bit redundant. We talked about typography back in the Photoshop module, module one of the class, or unit one. It is a little bit redundant. There are some definite similarities. A lot of the tools and techniques that you use modifying type in Illustrator crossover between the two programs. Illustrator is a vector-based tool, though, so the difference is in how you modify and manipulate that text. With Illustrator, you're going to be using vector-based tools. With Photoshop, you're going to be doing raster-based effects and special modifications to make things look like images when it's really text. So we'll get into just some of the basics. If you haven't gathered already from these lectures, I should have said this very beginning of the semester, but it should be obvious, I hope. If not, I apologize. But the point of these lectures is not to instruct you on everything that you need to know. It's to kind of fill in the cracks. The textbook reading is what's required, and that's going to get you the basis of knowledge that you need to be successful. And then my purpose with these lectures is to fill in the blanks and the things that I think might need a little bit more of attention, or that the book doesn't cover, or things that I just find interesting I want to tell you about. So here's what we're going to talk about today. Typekit, the touch type tool, styles for characters and paragraphs, and using the eyedropper tool in Illustrator. So first up, Adobe Typekit is a service that comes along with your Creative Cloud subscription. You have access to thousands of different fonts. Probably, I haven't counted, but there's a whole lot of fonts there available. And when I say fonts, of course, I mean typefaces. We talked about that before in the Photoshop section. But you have all these typefaces, font families, and then the font choices within that, of course. The nice thing about them is that they're searchable based on a wide variety of characteristics or classifications, recommendations for body or heading, paragraphs or titles, different properties like the weight of the text, the width of it, the height, and the contrast, and so on. Type of numerical characters, serif, sans serif, handwritten, so on. All these different characteristics that you can search by and sort by. Then you can also, of course, sort by name or search by name. You can enter in your own text to preview how it's going to look. And this is all pretty standard for a lot of different types of font services. So this one in particular, what's unique about it is that it's synchronized to your Creative Cloud account. So if I were to choose a font from this list on this page, I can click it, go in there and look at all the different fonts within those typefaces, and I can choose which ones I want to sync with my Creative Cloud applications. Once I do that, I can open Photoshop or Illustrator or InDesign or whatever else, and I'm going to have access to that font right there on my desktop. Different licenses for different typefaces. There's web use and print use. So some of them you're going to be able to use in web applications. And we don't get into that stuff here, but if you're using special fonts on the web, there are ways to do that. And Typekit is one of those. It's a very successful way to easily add type to your website. Things that aren't necessarily in a browser and aren't going to render properly in the user's browser. Anyway, Typekit's great. That's about all we're going to talk about in here. I want you guys to play around with it a bit and get familiar with it. It's one of those things that you're paying for this with your Creative Cloud subscription. If you're not taking advantage of it, you're not getting your money's worth out of that subscription plan. The touch type tool, moving on to a whole different topic here, is a tool for visually editing different characteristics of your text. There are some limitations, but in terms of making really rapid visual adjustments to characters within your words or whatever, it's great. It's fast, it's intuitive, and it's really easy. You can modify the baseline shift, the kerning, horizontal and vertical scale, rotation, and so on and so forth to modify things really quickly. And what's nice is that it retains text editability. So I can go in there and I could delete a character, or I could correct a typo, or I could change the size or whatever of the paragraph or heading or whatever it is that I'm working with. So touch type tool is pretty easy to use. If you just open up the touch type tool, you'll figure out pretty quickly how you interact with those different handles and rotation points. Text styles is where we start to get a little bit more advanced and refined. Part of being proficient with the program is knowing the tricks to make it go quickly. And this is one of those. So consistent usage of character styles and paragraph styles is going to set you apart, and it's going to make it a lot faster for you to accomplish tasks. The purpose of character and paragraph styles is to save presets or any adjustments or parameters that you add to a certain character or text, or paragraph, I should say, can be saved essentially like a preset. So that, let's say that I spend a fair amount of time customizing a heading. And that heading is going to be repeated, of course, throughout a document, like a newsletter or whatever it is that I'm working on, or a poster, whatever it may be. I can save that character style to reuse later, so that every time I add text, if I choose, I can apply that character style to that new text, and I don't have to go through and adjust the kerning and the leading and the tracking and all these other things that are available to us in the character and paragraph panels. So super fast, super easy, and I can synchronize that with my Creative Cloud libraries so that as I go from one document to the next, I retain those styles. Super helpful if you have maybe a set client that you do repeat work for and you're employed by this client, for example, in-house, then you can really easily maintain and save those styles so that you don't have to reinvent the wheel every time you create a new document. You just click on that style and apply it across the board throughout your document where you want to. Eyedropper Tool is another quick and easy way to transfer all those style parameters from one object to the next. This isn't just for type, but it does work pretty well for type. It copies attributes of your text or objects or shapes or whatever it is, and then it's going to paste them onto something else. So for example, this should be in the reading. You should cover it there, and you can try this out. Definitely recommend it in Illustrator. Everything I've covered so far, try it out in Illustrator. But in this case, just select some text and then use your eyedropper tool to click on something else, and it's going to sample the attributes from those other things. So this is pretty straightforward, and hopefully you guys get the hang of that pretty quick. It's a little different in Photoshop. Photoshop is just going to select the color that you click on, and it's going to load that into your those color chips in your color picker panel. So Photoshop and Illustrator is different. Illustrator, it's sampling attributes. Photoshop is just sampling colors. What's nice though is that sometimes you do want to just sample a color, and Illustrator will let you do that. If you, with your selection tool, just click on the object that you want to apply a color to, for example, let's say I have some type on my artboard, click on that artboard so it's selected, click on the eyedropper tool, and then this is where it gets a little bit tricky. You need to click on the artboard, just on a blank spot of the artboard. Don't let go. Hold the mouse down and move it off of the Illustrator window onto anything on your desktop, a browser window, a photo, whatever it is. And when you let go of the cursor, it's going to sample that RGB value from your desktop or other program or application or whatever it is. So that's a handy way to get colors into Illustrator. Sometimes that can be tricky, and having a color picker that can go into your operating system instead of just into the program is helpful to know about. In addition, you have all kinds of modifier keys that work. The typical ones, Shift and Alt, and the good old standby Shift plus Alt, will get you a long way with the eyedropper tool too. I'm not even going to go into what that does. I'd like you guys to play around with it and figure out some of the features that the eyedropper tool has that you can use modifier keys to access. Lastly, eyedropper options. This is kind of a feature. There's options for a lot of the tools in the Illustrator toolbar. If you double click on the tool icon, it's going to open up a panel sometimes, depending on what tool it is. And in this case, the eyedropper options panel is going to let you choose all the things that the eyedropper picks up. So let's say I wanted to only sample the color of the stroke. I can do that rather than having it sample everything else. So if I'm trying to be specific in what I'm sampling and copying, then this is how I would do that. Just double click on the icon for the eyedropper tool and open up the eyedropper options panel. So quick lecture this time. We're going to jump into the next one real quick and talk about color and get a little bit more in depth into Illustrator color features.